නමෝ තස්ස භගවතු අරහතෝ සම්මා සම්බුද්දස්ස An outline of Buddhism. On the full moon day of May, in the year 623 BC, there was born at Kapilavastu, on the Indian borders of Nepal, a Sakyan prince named Siddhartha Gautama, who was destined to be the greatest religious teacher in the world. Brought up in the lap of luxury, receiving an education befitting a prince, at 16 he married and had a son named Rahula. For 13 years after his happy marriage, he led a luxurious life, but his contemplative nature and boundless compassion did not permit him to enjoy the fleeting material pleasures of a royal household. He knew no woe, but he felt deep pity for sorrowing humanity. Amidst comfort and prosperity, he realized the universality of sorrow. The palace, with all its worldly allurements, was no longer a congenial place for the destined Buddha. The time was ripe for him to depart. Realizing the worthlessness of sensual enjoyments, highly prized by ordinary men, and the value of renunciation, in which the wise seek delight, in his 29th year, he renounced all worldly pleasures, and donning the simple yellow garb of an ascetic, alone, penniless, wandered forth in search of truth and peace. He sought the advice of the distinguished teachers of the day, but he could not achieve his object from outside sources. The painful austerities which he practiced proved absolutely futile. Circumstances compelled him to think for himself and seek within. He thought, and ultimately he realized for himself the truth which he could not get from teachers. Illumination came, light arose to reveal all things in their true nature. After a superhuman struggle of 6 strenuous years, unaided and unguided by any supernatural agency, and solely relying on his own efforts and wisdom, he eradicated all defilements, ended the process of grasping and realizing things as they truly are, by his own intuitive knowledge, became a Buddha, an enlightened or awakened one in his 35th year. He was not born a Buddha, but he became a Buddha by his own striving. As the perfect embodiment of all the virtues he preached, endowed with deep wisdom commensurate with his boundless compassion, he worked incessantly for the good and happiness of all, dominated by no personal motive, for 45 years, and passed away in his 80th year, leaving no successor, but exhorting the disciples to regard his doctrine and discipline as their teacher. His iron will, profound wisdom, universal love, boundless compassion, selfless service, historic renunciation, perfect purity, unique, magnetic personal life, the exemplary methods employed to propagate the teachings, and his final success. All these factors have compelled about 1/5 of the population of the world today to hail the Buddha as their supreme teacher. The moral and philosophical system expounded by the Buddha is called the Dhamma and is popularly known as Buddhism. Strictly speaking, Buddhism is not a religion, as it is not a system of faith and worship, owing any allegiance to a supernatural god. It's a course that guides a disciple through pure living and pure thinking to the gain of supreme wisdom and deliverance from all evil. Here, blind faith is dethroned and is substituted by confidence based on knowledge, saddha. Although a Buddhist seeks refuge in the Buddha as his incomparable guide and teacher, he makes no servile surrender. A Buddhism is neither a slave to a book nor to an individual. Without sacrificing his freedom of thought, he exercises his own free will and develops his wisdom even to the extent of becoming a Buddha himself, for all are potential Buddhas. Naturally, his followers quote the Buddha as the authority, but the Buddha himself discarded all authority. Immediate realization is the sole criterion of truth in Buddhism. Its keynote is rational understanding. Though such external forms of homage, as the offering of flowers and so forth, are prevalent amongst Buddhists, the Buddha is not worshipped as a god. There is no deification in the case of the Buddha. The Buddha was no doubt highly venerated in his own time, but he never arrogated himself divinity. He was a man, an extraordinary man, Acharya Manusa. Nevertheless, it should be remarked that there was no teacher ever so godless as the Buddha, yet none so godlike. What the Buddha expects from his disciples is not so much obeisance as the actual observance of his teaching. He honors me best, who practices my teaching best, is his admonition. Furthermore, prayers, petitional or intercessory, are foreign to Buddhism. On the contrary, great emphasis is laid on meditations that tend to self-discipline, self-control, purification, and enlightenment. In Buddhism, there is no God-creator to be obeyed and feared by a Buddhist. Instead of placing an unseen, almighty God over man, the Buddha has raised the worth of mankind. The Buddha teaches that man can gain salvation by self-exertion without depending on God or mediating priests. It expounds no dogmas that one must blindly believe, no creeds that one must accept on good faith without reasoning, no superstitious rites or ceremonies in order to enter the fold, no meaningless sacrifices or penances for one's purification. If, as Karl Marx says, religion is the soul of soulless conditions, the heart of a heartless world, the opium of the people, then Buddhism certainly is not such a religion. In fact, the cultural advancement of all Buddhist nations are due to the benign influence of Buddhism. If by religion is meant a system of deliverance from the ills of life, then Buddhism is the religion of religions. The foundations of Buddhism are the Four Noble Truths, which are associated with the so-called being. The Buddha states, in this very fathom-long body, along with its perceptions and thoughts, do I proclaim the world, the origin of the world, the cessation of the world, and the path leading to the cessation of the world. This interesting passage refers to the Four Noble Truths which the Buddha himself discovered by his own intuitive knowledge. Whether Buddhas arise or not, they exist. And it is the Buddha that reveals them to the deluded world. For the knowledge of these truths, which do not and cannot change with time, the Buddha was not indebted to anyone. As he himself said, they were unheard of before. Hence, there is no justification for the statement that Buddhism is a natural outgrowth of Hinduism. Although it is true that there are some fundamental doctrines common to both systems, and that is so because those doctrines are in accordance with eternal truth or Dhamma. The first truth deals with dukkha, which, for need of a better English equivalent, is rendered by suffering or sorrow. All life, to one who sees deep, is suffering. All are subject to birth, and consequently to decay, disease and death. No one is exempt from these four inevitable causes of suffering. Impeded wish is also suffering. In brief, this body itself is a cause of suffering. Instead of trying to rationalize suffering, the Buddha takes for granted that suffering exists and seeks the cause to eradicate the effect. The first truth of suffering, which is concerned with the constituents of the so-called being and the different phases of life, is to be carefully analyzed, scrutinized, and examined. This examination leads to a proper understanding of oneself as one really is. The cause of this suffering is craving or attachment, which is the second noble truth. This craving is a powerful, invisible mental force, latent in us all, and is the cause of all divergent, multifarious phenomena and noumena. This truth indirectly deals with the past, present, and future births. Right understanding of the first truth leads to the eradication of this craving. The second truth, which deals with the mental attitude of the ordinary man towards the external objects of sense. This craving, gross or subtle, which leads to repeated births and deaths, and which is the cause of all the ills of life, is such a potential force that one has to summon 8 equally powerful forces, eightfold path, to overcome this one single foe. The third noble truth is the complete cessation of suffering, which is achieved by the total eradication of all forms of craving. It is Nibbana, the summum bonum of Buddhism, which can be attained if the seeker fits himself for it in this life itself. The third truth, to depend on oneself, is beyond logical reasoning, atakkavachara, and is supramundane, unlike the first two, which are mundane. It is purely a realization, a dhamma to be comprehended by the mental eye by complete renunciation, not merely by renouncing external objects, but actually by renouncing internal attachment to the external world. It should be noted that the mere cessation of suffering or the mere destruction of craving is not Nibbana. If so, it would be tantamount to annihilation. Nibbana is a positive, unconditioned state. In Nibbana, nothing is annihilated, because Buddhism denies the existence of a permanent soul or Atma. Referring to Nibbana, the Buddha says, there is an unborn, ajata, unoriginated, abhuta, unmade, akata, and non-conditioned, asankhata. If there were not this unborn, unoriginated, unmade, and non-conditioned, an escaped one who is born, originated, made, and conditioned would not be possible here. The third truth has to be realized by developing the Noble Eightfold Path, which is the fourth noble truth. This is the via media, golden mean, majjhima patipada. It consists of right understanding, right thoughts, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right one-pointedness. These are the powerful moral mental forces that are summoned to attack one latent evil force, craving. The middle path, which constitutes morality, sila, concentration, samadhi, and insight, panya, is embodied in the following beautiful little verse. Sabbapapassa akaranam kusalassa upasampada satitta pariyodapanam etam buddhana sasanam. To cease from all evil, to do what is good, to cleanse one's mind, this is the advice of all the Buddhas. The first three truths deal with the philosophy of the Buddha's teaching, and the fourth with the practice in accordance with that philosophy. Buddhism as such is neither an ordinary philosophy which deals with theorizings irrelevant to one's deliverance from suffering and death, with no emphasis on practice and realization, nor an ordinary moral system, which though essential is only the ABC of Buddhism. The Buddha Dhamma is a moral and philosophical system which is founded on the bedrock of facts that can be tested and verified by personal experience. Buddhism is therefore rational and practical, devoid of esoteric doctrines, coercion, persecution, or fanaticism. To its unique credit, it should be said that during its peaceful march of 2,500 years, no drop of blood was shed in the name of the Buddha, and no conversion has ever been made either by force or by any repulsive method. Buddhism is saturated with the spirit of complete tolerance, which is extended to men, women, and all living beings. It was the Buddha who, for the first time in the known history of the world, attempted to abolish slavery. It was he who vehemently protested against the evils of the caste system that blocked the progress of mankind, and advocated equal opportunities for all, irrespective of caste, color, or rank. He established for both deserving men and women a celibate order, which was democratic in constitution and communistic in distribution. It was the Buddha who brought women to the realization of the importance to society. It was also the Buddha who banned the sacrifice of unfortunate animals and admonished his followers to extend their metta, a loving kindness to all living beings. It is only this Buddhist metta that can break down all the barriers which promote separatism. To a Buddhist, there is no far or near, an enemy or foreigner, no renegade or untouchable, since universal love, realized through understanding, establishes the brotherhood of all living beings. A real Buddhist is a citizen of the world, and he regards all as his brothers and sisters, making no distinction. Buddhism is therefore unique, mainly because of rationality, practicability, efficacy, and universality. It is the noblest of all unifying influences, and the only lever that can uplift the world to deliverance from suffering. In addition to the Four Noble Truths, the quintessence of Buddhism, the evidentially verifiable doctrines of karma and rebirth form two interrelated fundamental tenets of Buddhism. These two beliefs were present in India before the advent of the Buddha, but it was he who has explained and formulated them in the completeness we have them today. Karma is the law of moral causation. In its ultimate sense, karma means moral and immoral volition, kusala akusala chetana. It embraces both past and present actions. Hence, in one sense, we are the result of what we were. We will be the result of what we are. In another sense, it should be added, we are not totally the result of what we are. We will not absolutely be the result of what we were. The present, no doubt, is the offspring of the past and is the parent of the future. But the present is not always a true index of either the past or the future. So intricate is the law of karma. As we sow, we reap in this life or in a future birth. What we reap today is what we have sown either in the past or in the present. Karma is a law in itself, which operates in its own field without the intervention of any external independent ruling agency. This law of karma explains the problem of suffering, the mystery of fate and predestination of other religions, infant prodigies, and above all, the inequality of mankind. Rebirth is the corollary of karma. The bodhisattva ideal and the correlative doctrine of freedom to attain utter perfection are based on the belief in rebirth. It is karma that conditions rebirth. Past karma conditions the present birth, and present karma, in combination with past karma, conditions the future. The actuality of the present needs no proof, as it is self-evident. That of the past is based on memory and report, and that of the future on forethought and inference. The Buddhist doctrine of rebirth should be differentiated from the theory of reincarnation and transmigration of other systems, because Buddhism denies the existence of a transmigrating, permanent soul created by God or emanating from Paramatma. Buddhism resolves the living being into mind and matter, nama and rupa, which are in a state of constant flux. The whole process of these mental and physical phenomena, which are constantly becoming and passing away, is at times, in conventional terms, called a self or atma by the Buddha. But it is a process and not an identity that is thus termed. Buddhism does not deny the existence of an apparent personality. It denies an ultimate identical being or a permanent entity, but it does not deny continuity in process. The Buddhist philosophical term for an individual is santati, that is flux or continuity. This uninterrupted flux or continuity of mental and physical phenomena, conditioned by karma, having no perceptible source in the beginningless past, nor an end in its continuation in the future, except by the Noble Eightfold Path, is the Buddhist substitute for the permanent ego or eternal soul in other religious systems. As T.H. Huxley states, Buddhism is a system which knows no God in the Western sense, which denies a soul to man, which counts the belief in immortality a blunder, which refuses any efficacy to prayer and sacrifice, which bids men look to nothing but their own efforts for salvation, which in its original purity knew nothing of vows of obedience and never sought the aid of the secular arm, yet spread over a considerable moiety of the world with marvelous rapidity and is still the dominant creed of a large fraction of mankind. May you all be well and happy.
Mitta Suttanta, Discourse on Loving Kindness. He who is skilled in his good and who wishes to attain that state of calm should act thus. He should be able, upright, perfectly upright, obedient, gentle and humble, contented, easily supportable, with few duties, of light livelihood, controlled in senses, discreet, not impudent, not be greedily attached to families. He should not commit any slight wrong, such that other wise men might censure him. May all beings be happy and secure. May their hearts be wholesome. Whatsoever living beings there be, feeble or strong, long, stout or medium, short, small or large, seen or unseen, those dwelling far or near, those who are born and those who are to be born, may all beings without exception be happy-minded. Let none deceive another, nor despise any person whatsoever in any place. In anger or ill will, let him not wish any harm to another. Just as a mother would protect her only child at the risk of her own life, even so, let him cultivate a boundless heart towards all beings. Let his thoughts of boundless love pervade the whole world, above, below, and across, without any obstruction, without any hatred, without any enmity. Whether he stands, walks, sits, or lies down, as long as he is awake, he should develop this mindfulness. This, they say, is the highest conduct here. Not falling into error, virtuous and endowed with insight, he discards attachment to sensuous desires. Of a truth, he does not come again for conception in a womb.